go ahead and get started.
Hello?
So that means, okay, thank you. So for those, I'm stuck here in the middle because I'm going to be doing the slides for Amy, but I want to thank you all very much for coming. I think I know all of you, but if you don't know me, I'm Claudia, I'm the library director. And I've just been doing a little raise your hand survey to see how people heard about this program. So how many people heard about it via our email?
The newsletter?
Oh, yeah. Okay. The Lakeville Journal? Salisbury Sampler? Okay. And anything else? Okay. And was that a poster in the library or?
Oh, just,
it was Barbara telling us in our Spanish class.
Okay, well, very good. So thank you. So I'm very glad that you all made it, and this is, this never fails, that it, when you least want it to. Anyhow, so this is another in our series of local people who live more interesting lives than I do, and so, which would be a lot of people. But so today, oh my goodness. Excuse me, one minute. It works fine until you are ready to use it.
It's
on too long. Yeah. We'll see what this does. So anyhow, today we have Amy Lake. She lives in Lakeville. She's a teacher at the Kellogg School, and she's done a number of interesting trips. This is her second time coming to the library, and she's going to talk to you today about her journey to Tanzania in 2010. Mm-hmm. And I will turn it over to Amy, and we're going to do this, hopefully, a good coordination of slides and speaking. So let me.
So, karibu.
Karibu.
Asante sana for your attendance today. Yeah, 2010, I was so fortunate to be chosen as one of 12 teachers to be part of a Fulbright Hayes group project abroad to Africa. The focus of our project was contemporary Islam as a lived experience in Muslim communities in Egypt and Tanzania. Today I plan to share my observations and experiences, and afterwards I will answer any questions to the best of my ability that you may have. So first of all, whoops, hide that.
Oh, sorry.
I wanted you to open up your mental maps before you saw this slide. So where in the world is Tanzania? And where in Africa, north or south of the equator? Start to tell your neighbors. Okay, can you name its eight neighbors? Tell each other, please. You can show it. Okay. Okay, now you can have the next slide. There you go. And the next, there's the countries for you to name them. Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda. Oops, you're going too fast for me there. So what is its approximate size? And if you go to the next slide, it's slightly twice the size of California. Africa, remember, is the second largest continent in the world. And even today, in the Hartford Current a few years ago, they talked about Africa being the country with some of the world's worst sanitation issues. So, you know, we don't get it right. We think of Africa as a single country, but it's made up of over 54 countries. The Republic of Tanzania was, as the country is officially known, is younger than I am. It was formed in 1964. With the union of mainland Tanganyika and the islands of the archipelago, the Zanzibar archipelago. I want to point out the route that, I wanted to point out where you're going to go today on tour. We're going to land here in Dar and take a ferry right over to Zanzibar. And in Zanzibar, we're going to go to Stone Town or Zanzibar City. And then we will head to a festival in Makunduchi and out to this seaside village of Weju. Afterwards, we'll head up the coastline to Bagamoyo, and then inland to Arusha, and then we will go to a little village, and lastly, we'll go to Ngorongoro Crater. All right, so off to Zanzibar. We'll take a ferry 22 miles across the Zanzibar Channel to Unguja Island, less than the size of Connecticut. Stumptown, as it's called, is recognized as a UN World Heritage Site and is the birthplace of Freddie Mercury of Queen fame. This fort was built in the 1700s and it was used by the Arabs to repel the Portuguese.
Wow.
Stumptown architecture reflects the geographic and cultural influences. The houses are tightly packed huddles accessed via narrow alleyways to keep out the heat and glare. Another peek here, see the intense shadows. So you can walk, even though it's really hot at midday, and find shade to keep you cool. Keep going. And privacy. This is the doorway of my homestay house, and behind that blue door is an open courtyard. So buildings look inward onto cool courtyards. Next picture, and external balconies veiled with intricately carved wooden screens. Privacy was important, especially for women. Zanzibar is predominantly Muslim, and so privacy and modesty for women. And also in the, whoops, hang on a second. Go ahead. And the next one. At the height of Stumptown's growth in the 19th century, status became more important over modesty, and doors favored means were the favored means of expressing opulence and grandeur of one's mansion inside. The coralline rock of Zanzibar is easily eroded. Go ahead. And with the majority of Zanzibari subsisting on a dollar a day, preservation is severely underfunded. And this is a palace museum. I looked out the window at the other part of it and it's quite crumbling. Zanzibar was one of the most important trading centers on the Indian Ocean. Bound by treaty and enforced by the Sultan's military, all East African trade, you're going to zip through a few of these, Claudia, was through Zanzibar. Its zenith was the 1870s. The Omani sultans who controlled Zanzibar after the expulsion of the Portuguese grew wealthy from trade. These are a couple of their portraits. Dates, wheat, beads, and Chinese ceramics from Arabia came to Zanzibar. Cloves, go ahead, nutmeg. And here's some other spices that grow there today. We went to a spice plantation. Ivory and human trafficking were all funneled through Zanzibar. This is the takeoff place in Bagamoyo that where the ivory and human cargo were shipped out to Zanzibar before being exported across the Indian Ocean to other locations. History is also written in the landscape of everyday life, in the foods like plantains from Southeast Asia, Indian curry and chapatis, ideas of beauty, and the languages spoken. Go ahead.
Oh,
look again.
Okay.
Omani Arabs controlled Zanzibar after the Portuguese ousted them at the turn of the 18th century, bringing Arabic. And Kiswahili, of course, was originally written in Arabic script to spell the words phonetically until Edward Steer, who was a bishop, wrote an English Swahili dictionary in the Roman alphabet. In 1884, the Berlin Conference made Zanzibar a British protectorate. And so we have the English. And Kiswahili sayings are all over the place, including the primary mode of dress there, the kanga, which I have hung up, So you wear your politics like a t-shirt and the saying on your condo. And my homestay family had given me one that I passed on to my sister that said something about love. It was white and red. And I was running low on clothes and hadn't done my laundry. So I wore this conga around Dar. And I got quite a few comments by the men on the sidewalk. Oh, it said something about, you know, I love you. And I said, I'm talking to my husband. But the religions practice. Tanzania is nearly equally divided when it comes to religion. One third identify themselves as Christian. My Muslim homestay mother attended a school run by the Catholic Church you just saw. And this Anglican church was built over the whipping post from the island's largest slave market. And the church has a cross made from the tree under which Dr. Livingstone's heart was buried. One third of Tanzanians identify themselves as followers of Islam. And the other third are a combination including local indigenous beliefs and other religions such as Hinduism. And that was a temple in Zanzibar. Unlike mainland Tanzania, Zanzibar is 99% Muslim. And you can see just how big that comes out here, you know, disproportionate to the rest of Africa. But history, culture, and religion intersect dramatically in Zanzibar. For example, practicing Muslims in the village of Makunduchi make food offerings to the spirit world to implore certain ancestors to intercede on their behalf. The white and the red cloth tied around that post can ward off the evil eye. So that whole notion of the evil eye, which is very much part of the Eastern Mediterranean, carried here perhaps by traders. Okay. The Mwaka Kogwa Festival is another eclectic blend of religious traditions. Introduced by the Zoroastrian immigrants from Persia over 1,000 years ago, this ritual is intended to cleanse the old year and bless the new. Two groups of men with braided cane and banana stalks are going to fight here until one cries uncle. And they start, begin by parading around the meadow. First the young boys came out, and then later on, the men. And they were dressed in all kinds of outfits. You can see the guy has a colander on his head. And he's probably smart to do so because they're going to really whack each other with those. Girls and women then start running around taunting the men to encourage them to, you know, encourage their machismo. And then they meet. Past years, misunderstandings are exercised. In the new year, nothing will make them fight again. Later on, a brush house is set up in the center of this fighting area, and it's set alight. And the men that are inside it wait until the last moment before making good their escape. We were pressed together so tightly here that I actually got knocked over 3 times and propped back up. And there was such a good feeling here of, this euphoric feeling and this pleasure of sharing it. The idea is that the more people who witness this festival, the stronger the festival is. And so because I was something like that. And they knew I was a teacher. They kept pushing me up to the front. I had a video camera. They wanted me to videotape the whole process. So the smoke that issues indicates the direction in which the fortunes of the following year will blow. Afterwards, the local imam brought us to the village mosque, which is built under a sacred tree. And then if we go inside, you'll notice the red and white cloth again to ward off the evil eye. And here it is inside the mosque at on either side of the mihrab, the niche in the wall of a mosque that indicates the direction of Mecca. On to Gweju. This is a setting for a National Geographic film segment from their Africa series, which I believe you have here at the library. And it's about the it's a segment featuring the Zanzibar leopards. And whoops, if you go back, that's leopard soccer team captain Issa figures prominently in the film, and we were able to meet and talk with him about his experiences in this project. Issa, like the people of Makunduchi, lived largely in homes made of coral. And the mortar to put these together is made locally in a kiln. I said, oh, we make kilns too to make lime and iron in part of the world where I'm from. So here they are building it, and they'll set those logs afire. Gweju lies on the coast. The people here raise a few cows, goats. They harvest coconuts and make twine from the sea-soaked shells. But mostly the villagers make their living off the sea. I'm going to just shoot through three photos here. There's a trap. They use outrigger boats. This was at 6 o'clock in the morning. Saw people heading out to fish. And capture delicious kingfish and octopus, among others. The young women are seaweed farmers. Perhaps you've enjoyed Zanzibari seaweed in your ice cream or your toothpaste. Issa's desire to build his own house is frustrated by rising real estate costs driven by foreign investment. Speculated that today's young would be driven out of Gweju as more of the idyllic coastline is developed into resorts for the rich. But tourism does offer job opportunities, low-paying though most may be. These young Maasai men that you just saw left the dry scrub grazing land on the mainland to earn money selling beaded jewelry to vacationers. One of Zanzibari's attractions for me was this blend of cultures. This eclectic mix of tradition and modernity. And it's so evident in this photo of my homestay family. Just stay here for a minute and take a look at that. Okay. 27-year-old Ashu, go to the next picture. Wears a bui bui, which means spider, and it's the black robe, so it's nicknamed as a spider. She wears it in public and maintains her hijab even when visiting the family. So she visited several times and never was unscarved. 24-year-old Habiba, whose name means love, by the way, left the house at 10 o'clock at night in this racy garb to go to a club. And 10-year-old Halima dresses for her Arabic classes that she attends one night a week. And 40-year-old mom Zayana, who was next to her, is quite comfortable around the house just wrapped in one of her kangas. The kanga, or kanga, the fashion choice of most Tanzanian women, is a living legacy of the past. Arab traders brought their cotton to the Swahili coast. But the name kanga is after the guinea fowl whose polka-dotted plumage resembled the first designs imported by the Portuguese merchants. So you get this blend here. And they can be worn in many different ways, including some high fashion. One of the books that for sale in tourist shops in Zanzibar was 101 Ways to Wear a Kanga.
And the kanga is what?
It's the cloth hanging up. It comes in two pieces. It's right there in front of you. And you can do all kinds of things with it, like wear it as, looks like I have to do it this way, wear it as a scarf and a hat, hanging on rusty, but I remember it's something like my homestay mothers would always laugh at me when I would do this. Like this, and you tuck it in for the top, and it becomes like a shirt, and then you have the second piece around the bottom. So my homestay family teaches all of us to challenge the limitations of stereotypes. And so did meeting Layla Saeed Abdullah, the co-captain of the women fighters soccer team, featured in a documentary called Zanzibar Queens. The team was founded in 1998, you can click ahead, and persevered through some pretty intense opposition to their very existence. Women, Muslim women, playing soccer, dressed so immodestly. Now keep in mind, we're in a 90 degree or better temperatures here. So to me, they're quite heavily dressed for playing soccer. But this team persevered and even sent a member to the national team. Perhaps the players would agree with the sentiments expressed by this Tinga Tinga artist, which he painted on the wall behind him. It says, "Only God can judge me." Cousin Hamoud is a cake decorator. Here he's cooking mandazi, a really sweet fried dough, and this is within their house. Supper is eaten on the busati, or floor mat. My family treated me to chicken and octopus curry, and an avocado, banana, and passion fruit smoothie. Mm-hmm. We eat with our hands. Zayana rents her gated courtyard to as storage space for this man's sugarcane juice equipment. And if you've never had fresh pressed sugarcane juice with a squeeze of lime, it's just delicious. When you get to Zanzibar, order one up. By the way, shoes off upon entering, a very smart custom in a dusty, sandy town. My family must be making up for lost time. They had a power outage for 3 months a few years ago when the cable to the mainland broke, and the TV was on 24/7. I saw my first Beyonce video here. All too soon, though, it's time to say kwaheri to Zanzibar and karibu to mainland Tanzania. Container ships like this one, we saw up to 16 in view as we crossed the channel at one time. They were just everywhere. Zoom, zoom, zoom. The name, Dar es Salaam, is derived from, oh, there we are, just to reorient you. Okie doke. The name is derived from Arabic, meaning a safe port. We've been advised, and you can just click through a few of these. We've been advised to dress modestly, as Dar is largely Islamic. So I wore a black buoy that I purchased in Cairo. It had all this little silver bling up and down it, to a nightclub, because that was part of the experience. We went out at midnight to check out the night scene. But I could have dressed 20 women at that club with the fabric in my one dress. One local man we spoke to echoed Issa's resentment over foreign investment, securing key national assets such as the beachfront property you just saw. Go ahead. He maintains that such development does little to address local needs. We boarded a bus, public bus, to Arusha, but there's lots of different ways to get around. This is an open bus called a Dala Dala, and we saw a lot of people transporting cargo by bike. I think that would make an interesting topic for a book, everything on a bike. This is the evidence of the dangers of the rainy season. A very, very deep, I would say at least a yard deep, open drainage ditch. Mm-hmm. I think parallel parking could be very hazardous here. But those without wheels have to carry their car themselves. Go ahead, a few of those. In Bagamoyo, we happened upon a fish auction. Very exciting. These dhows were just beaching up on the shores and spilling out their fish. And almost as fast as they could bring it onto the beach, it was being hauled away for the family dinner. We passed miles and miles of sisal plantations. You can click through a few of these. In 1893, a German agronomist smuggled samples of this succulent plant out of its native habitat on the Yucatan Peninsula in Mexico. He took them to Germany's East Coast colony of Tanganyika. The hardy plant produces some of nature's longest and strongest plant fibers. It thrived in Tanzania's hot tropical sun, and by the early 20th century was producing ropes for the German naval fleet. Under German, then British administrators, the sisal fiber became the colony's main export commodity. And when the Republic of Tanzania was born in 61, it was the world's biggest sisal grower. And you may have some of it in your homes. The red earth of Tanzania impresses. Go ahead. The color comes from the high iron content in the soil. Although only 4% of the land is arable, 75% of the people live on farms. Many rural homes are made out of unfired mud brick and protected from the rains by plated mats. From the bus window, we saw low-budget mining and brick-making operations. Fired bricks are common building material. Some different styles as well we saw from the bus. So now we're in the north central part of the country, and we were fortunate enough to get to see Kilimanjaro, albeit from a moving bus window. And we landed in Arusha, the geographic center of Africa, midway between Cairo and Cape Town. It is also the home of the International War Crimes Tribunal, which we visited, and some fantastic markets. Here, Maasai women sell their beadwork. The Maasai, the best known African ethnic group, due to their residence near the many game parks in East Africa and their distinctive customs and dress. The government has instituted programs to encourage the Maasai to abandon their semi-nomadic lifestyle, but many have continued their traditions. We stayed with families in Imbasani village outside of Arusha. Our homestays were arranged through the United African Alliance Community Center. There you see, oh, go back one. You see the kanga like I showed you I was trying to wear, top and bottom? So go ahead. This run by former Kansas City natives Peter O'Neill and his wife Mama Charlotte. Pete is a former Black Panther and a subject of a film, A Panther in Africa, which you can get through the library's interlibrary loan if you want to watch it. The community center provides classes in fine and performing arts, English, and computer technology. It also has its own radio station, and an orphanage, and a school. The people of Imbasani have no electricity and no plumbing. My homestay family of five kids, that is, and two parents, live in that three-room house you just saw. If you go back. This is an external kitchen on the left. A little shed, a kitchen shed, and their precious bicycle is hanging from the ceiling in their center room. The room behind, there's a door open to the outside, and then that's a room to a bedroom that has two beds, and the family gave up their bed. Obviously, they share beds. There's only three beds in the house. There's seven people. Most of the other people in my Fulbright group had to share a bed with one or two other people, but my homestay family gave me up their whole, like, full-size bed to myself. So I was very touched by that generosity. According to the World Bank, the per capita GDP of Tanzania is $532, compared to the U.S. at over $48,000. My family carries water from a spring a quarter mile from their house, and I wanted to go to the spring and carry water. So I was surrounded by children who sang, and we skipped a quarter mile to the spring and then huffed and puffed our way back. And that water is just wash water. The potable water is over a half mile away at the community center where a well and public access has been created. Imagine hauling water to wash clothes for five children. Most meals in rural Tanzania are cooked on a three-stone stove like the one, in the next picture. And this is where we ate. The four older children just sat on the floor, and the mom and dad and I shared the burger. So there's the stove with the wood, and then the wood is pulled out if you want to reduce the flame, and it's pushed back in if you want to make it hotter. The problem with pulling it out is it makes it incredibly smoky, as you'll see in the next picture, to cook in. And so imagine respiratory problems abound. My mom prepared chapatis in a smoky shed. While I filmed the neighbors who arrived in mass in the front yard, they performed all sorts of feats of daring for me all afternoon. And I'm talking the adults too. The men, if you'll just pause here for a minute, the men were doing one-armed push-ups, and then push-ups between pieces of furniture, and they'd crowd around and watch, and then things just kept ramping up. Oh, well, I could do a one-handed flip, and it was a whole lot of fun. But necessity is the mother of invention, and toys. Oh, here we go. Oh, wow. Toys like the pinwheels you'll see in this next picture can be made from discarded water bottles, or a version of Jack's can be played with an avocado pit and some stones. And you can jump a vine as easily as a rope, and there's the shed. The left side where there's the corrugated metal is where the chickens and doves are kept, and the right side is the kitchen. Go ahead. And that is the outhouse off to the back there. The people grow corn here and then plant beans, replenish the soil. They shade their coffee bushes with banana plants. They grow sugar cane and culture bees. That's a bee hive there, that little log hanging from the tree. Yeah, I thought that was interesting. I guess beeswax was one of the commodities that was exported out of East Africa. While Islam is concentrated along the coast in Tanzania, it followed the trade routes inland to inland markets. So Imbasani village is predominantly Muslim. Our families brought us all to Friday services at the mosque. This is a larger mosque closer to Arusha. If you go back to that slide, we're leaning up against the mosque. And so the women, we all were in the back. And it was interesting because in Cairo, when we visited a mosque, we were there as observers and we were asked not to participate in any way. Here, the women had us, they wanted us to follow along with the different motions, movements of prayer, so that we could get a feel for it as well as a look at it. Okay. We visited a village school, the village school, and were swarmed by curious children. They were soon reined in by their able principal. We visited a classroom, boys on one side, girls on the other. Some of their lessons. Amazingly, while on a walk in the village, I happened upon an internet cafe. The ability to connect with the world, the outer world, may offer new opportunities for these children. Of course, one can't leave East Africa without going on safari. We took a trip to the Ngorongoro crater, the largest unbroken caldera in the world. And on our way down to the floor of the crater, we passed a Maasai village and saw herdsmen and their flocks grazing in the same area where we spotted 9 lions. So this is part of the national park. We'll just click through these. These are all found within the crater. And more animals. I didn't have a telephoto lens, so those are a couple of the lions we saw ranging close by where the flocks were. And we saw a few elephants. I can't remember the name of that colorful bird. But these are weaver bird nests. And you click again, we'll get closer. And one more click should bring up the little weaver bird. Aren't they amazing? They're so beautiful. Out we go. This is a baobab tree, and a Ghanaian proverb asserts that truth is like a baobab tree. No one person's hands can encircle it. Our group of 14, including our 2 leaders, it took all of us to encircle this one tree. And so it's just a nice way for me to end, to say that it's true. Multiple perspectives are so important because no one has a monopoly on the truth. It's up to us to go out and find it for ourselves. Thank you very much. I'll be happy to answer any questions.